please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
I'm pleased to say that I am joined now by Raghuram Rajan, the former RBI governor, of course, but also a professor for finance at Chicago Booth. And Raghuram, thank you for your time for joining us today on CNBC. And a lot of speculation over the next Fed chairman. Mm-hmm. You may have seen the report in Barron's magazine saying that you would be their candidate to take the post. So let's just clear the air. Did you get a call from the Oval Office?
Yeah. No, I didn't. And there's not a chance that that would happen.
So let's talk about the market odds-on favorite at the moment. Seems to be Jay Powell. Is there an assumption that he will take the post? And if so, what kind of Fed will this look like under Jay Powell?
Well, first, I don't have any more information than what's being discussed out there. If it is Jay Powell, what I hear is, he's somebody who assembles opinions together, takes a reasoned view, moves ahead. He's a consensus person. From Fed insiders, they think very highly of him. I think regardless of the choice, however, the Fed is like a supertanker. It doesn't turn on a dime. So whoever comes in, whether it's, the usual names, John Taylor or somebody else, or whether it's Janet Yellen continuing, it's hard to imagine the Fed moving off from what it's already doing. A Fed chairman takes years, even if they have strong opinions which differ from the prevailing wisdom of the Fed, to change people's opinions there. So my sense is we should expect continuity.
And what are the prospects that we get someone like John Taylor in the vice chair role? Because the market, when you look at their reaction and the Treasury yields, they seem to think he will bring in a much more hawkish policy. But nevertheless, you're saying it's going to be data dependent, with the Fed still trying to crack this inflation puzzle.
If John Taylor comes in, he's one amongst a number of people, and he's also quite reasonable. He understands the kind of job he has, and what he has to do to move people's opinions. It's not this is my way or the highway. It is, how do we think about this? He has to convince others. So I think all the talk about, different candidates moving the Fed significantly off course is probably overstated in the short run. In the medium term, of course, they will have very different Feds depending on who's there in the chairman or the vice chairman position.
If the Fed is a supertanker, as you suggest, are they moving in the right direction?
I think yes. I think the Fed is exiting from the extremely accommodative conditions. And the question one should be asking is, if not now, when? There is always a danger that they move too fast. But I think at this point, there's an equal danger that they move too slowly.
Right.
And so if you've got critics on both sides, you're typically moving at the right pace.
And the reason some say there's a danger of moving too slowly is the risk in financial stability. Are you concerned about those risks now?
Well, I think before you get to financial stability, there is a risk that, as we see labor markets tighten, it is possible that we get an inflation signal which is not acceptable to the markets, which looks stronger than we've had so far. If that happens in the sense the Fed is not moving in a measured way, then perhaps the market will anticipate stronger, faster movement by the Fed, and that could be as damaging to financial markets as the Fed moving too fast. So being behind the curve and being seen to be behind the curve could be problematic. There's also the concern, as you correctly put it, that inflation is the first concern, but there is a second concern of financial stability. If the Fed stays too low for too long, do those risks build up?
And what about the implications here for inequality? Because we were just having a discussion off camera. One of the big topics here are this politics of rage. Some of that is driven by inequality, by the gap and the divide we're seeing. Do you think that quantitative easing has fueled that in some ways?
I don't think it's been a big factor. But I do think that when the Fed comes in and over time follows a set of policies, it's favoring one set of people versus the other. Interest rates in the normal course do that, but they also move up and down, and so they balance out. When it moves in one direction over a long period, people start asking questions. For example, in Germany, there are questions about whether savers are being disadvantaged relative to borrowers by ECB policy. So I think these questions are natural. But for the central bank to be at the center of questions which really belong in the political sphere, do you favor these guys or favor those guys, I think it's problematic.
Let's talk about India for a minute, because big news on the bank recapitalizations there. We've seen some rather bullish forecasts on what this could mean for growth in India. What is your assessment?
I think this is good news. I think it's important that the banks have the capital to be able to lend going forward. And the public sector banking system is a big part of the Indian system. It's about 70% still. More important, it allows them to take tough decisions on cleaning up their balance sheet, which they couldn't earlier because they had more limited capital. So I think this is good. The government should be clean about it. We are putting our resources behind the banks and move forward.
Is it necessary but also sufficient, or does more need to be done in the way of reform as well?
Well, I think more needs to be done in the way of reform over time. I think we have to think about the governance of the public sector banks and how that can be improved. And there are various options there. But I think for the immediate future, it's important to clean up bank balance sheets so that the healthier the balance sheets are, the healthier the projects that have been restructured with the appropriate debt, the stronger the economy can grow.
And also in the Indian economy, many looking to the one-year anniversary, really, of demonetization going into force. What is your assessment of the impact we've seen so far? Do you think the country's about to turn a corner?
Well, I think it was, it did affect economic activity, and economic activity slowed down. There have been other factors like the goods and services tax, which came in. The goods and services tax, in my view, is long-run positive. And there were always going to be glitches in implementing it. But going forward, these three, fixing the debt, the impact of demonetization waning, and the goods and services tax, fixing that and figuring out how to work it in a low-cost environment, will be growth positive for India.
So was demonetization worth the short-term pain?
I think we still don't know enough about it. And I suspect there's been a fair amount of distress in the informal sector. And I mean, those kinds of calculations are more political than economic.